So welcome to the first session on limits. Limits is not a new concept to you because we have done extensive limits in our bridge course. But that doesn't mean I will not talk about the basics. Of course, I'll start with basics, but you can expect me to be slightly faster. But at the same time, if you feel you want to revisit a particular concept again, please feel free to stop me at any place you want me. So, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the first session on limits. In the bridge course, we had already discussed the informal approach of finding the limit, right? So in informal approach, we had taken some example and we had understood how do we find out the left-hand limit, right-hand limit, by trying to come close to the value that x is tending to from left and right of that value. And then we see what is the value to which your function is tending to. So when I say limit of a function as x tends to a is L, it basically means that as you are approaching a, whether you approach from the left of a, whether you approach from the left side of a left hand, or you approach from right hand, okay, basically left hand is what we write as x tending to a minus. Okay, so on the superscript we put a minus sign. That doesn't mean minus a. Again, I'm repeating it, a with a superscript of minus doesn't mean minus a. It just means you are approaching a from a slightly lesser value than a. For example, if a is 4, you are approaching a like 3.9 3.99 3.999. Such approaches towards 4 from slightly lesser than 4 is called approaching 4 from left hand side. Right hand limit is what we write as x tending to a plus. Okay, so as x tends to a, this is what we read it as, x tends to a, the value of the function tends to L or may even achieve L. Okay, then this value is what we call as the limit of the function. This is called the limit of the function as x tends to a. And this value L should be the same irrespective of whether you are approaching a from left to a or right to a. Okay, this is the basic informal definition that we had, informal definition of limits. Okay, there is something called epsilon delta definition, which is not of very great significance to us, but since many books talk about it, we'll also talk about epsilon delta definition. Epsilon delta definition. It says that if the difference between x and a is tending to delta, where delta is a very, very small quantity, okay, then the difference between the function and L should tend to epsilon. Okay, where delta and epsilon both are infinitesimally small quantity. So where delta and epsilon are infinitesimal quantities. Okay. Now, unlike the bridge course, I will not be going into again some examples. You have already done this in school. So we'll talk directly about methods to evaluate limit. Okay. Anybody has any confusion about the meaning of limits? Yeah. Which definition, Shraddha? You want me to repeat epsilon delta definition? Epsilon delta definition is basically when your gap between x and a is tending to zero, which we call as delta normally, then the gap between the function and the actual limit of the function as x tends to a will also tend to a very infinitesimal quantity, which we call as epsilon. Okay, so this is the epsilon delta definition. If you want, I can show a small graph for the same. So basically it tries to say that, let's say there is any function like this, and this is your a value. Okay, so let's say you're very close to a, very close to A, either to the left of A or to the right of A, right? And this gap is your delta gap. Okay. Then your gap between the value of the function in the neighborhood of L, this gap is what we call as the epsilon gap. Okay. So as you are closing the gap with A, even the gap of the function and its limit is closing its gap. Okay. So F will approach L as X will approach A. That is what I'm trying to say in a different way. That is called the epsilon delta definition. Okay. So this is what is normally seen in many books. That's why I thought I will talk about it. But this is not of much use to us. Probably in undergrad, you will talk more about it. Okay. Now, what are the standard ways or what are the methods to solve limits? Before we go on to that, I would like to highlight few important things. Very, very important pointers about limit. Okay. I'll also check your understanding of your limits by giving you some questions. But before we proceed, I would like to discuss this. Number one, limit of a function as x tends to a is always a finite quantity. Remember, limit, you cannot say limit is infinity. Okay. However, you can say that your left hand limit or your right hand limit could be plus or minus infinity. So these guys could be plus or minus infinity, but under no situation you will say limit is infinity. What will you say instead? Limit does not exist. Are you getting my point? But it may happen that your left hand limit is infinity, or your right hand limit is also infinity, or your left hand limit is minus infinity, right hand limit is also minus infinity. So please remember, infinity and two infinities are not the same. Okay. So in those cases, you say limit does not exist. Right? Even if it is plus infinity, minus infinity, then definitely it will not exist. That is number one point. Number two point is, if your left hand limit and right hand limit values, they don't match despite being finite. Let's say these two quantities both are finite, but their values do not match. So despite being finite quantities, their values do not match. Then we'll say in such cases also that the limit of the function as x tends to a does not exist. Okay, this does not exist. DNE. Okay, even if those are infinite. So even if, let's say, your f of x as x tends to a plus is tending to infinity, and same is your limit as x tends to a minus. Even in this case, you will say. That this does not exist. Okay. This I have already talked about a few minutes ago. I don't want to repeat it again. Third important point, which I would like to discuss with you in some detail, is the comparison between the limit of a function as x tends to a and the value of the function at x equal to a. Okay. What are the difference between these terms? Are you experiencing any kind of a lag when I'm writing? Anybody is experiencing any kind of a lag? No, it's fine. Absolutely fine, right? Okay. Now I would like to discuss this difference unnoticeable. Okay. I would discuss this difference in some detail with you. Of course, they are different, but at the same time, at certain conditions, they are same also. Okay. So I would like to discuss the similarity as well as difference between these two concepts. Okay, of course they are not the same always, else I would not have studied, or you would not have studied this chapter separately. You would have studied it under functions chapter only. Okay. Right, Prakul. Yes, that is what I'm going to discuss. Okay. So I would like to discuss few cases with you. Okay. The first case is a case where it may happen that that limit of a function as x tends to a exists, but the value of the function at a does not exist. Okay. So what I'm trying to bring out, certain things which will make you realize that they are not the same, or if they are same, when they are same. Okay. So the first point or first case which I'm going to discuss is there may be cases where your function limit as x tends to a will exist, but the value of the function at a may not exist or does not exist. Can you give me an example like this? I'm sure you would have done several examples where this particular case has been, or whether this case is seen. Right. So one example I would cite here is, let's say limit x square minus 4 by x minus 2 as x tends to 2. Correct? Correct? Okay. No. People are citing wrong examples now. Signum function, Raghav, is defined for all values of x. There is no such value of x for the signum function, does not exist. You can find signum of any value. Okay. Yes, sin x by x is a good example. Sin x by x doesn't exist at 0, but the limit as x tends to 1, x tends to 0 becomes 1. Okay. Yes, there are several examples. So this limit, we have all seen that this limit is 4. Correct. But if you talk as a function here, this function. So let's say if you have this function x square minus 4 by x minus 2. Okay. F of 2 does not exist. It is not defined because your denominator, of course, numerator also becomes 0. So it is exactly 0 by exactly 0 means the expression is undefined. Okay. But limit of x square minus 4 by x minus 2 as x tends to 2 exists, and it is 4. Correct. This is number one. This is case one, which I wanted to show you. Now look at case two. It may happen that limit of the function as x tends to a. What happened to my equal? X tends to a does not exist. But your function at a exists. Okay. Right. This is a second line of difference that you may see. And can you give me an example for the same? Now, signum example that he cited. That's a beautiful example for this. So if you want to find out what is the limit of signum function, SGN function, as x tends to 0. This does not exist. Why doesn't it exist? It's just that simple. If you draw a signum function graph, I hope you all know the signum function graph. Signum function gives you 0 when x is 0, gives you 1 when x is positive, and gives you minus 1 when x is negative. Right? Yes or no? So the definition of signum function, I'll write once again. Many people ask me, sir, what is the definition of signum function? I still don't know it. So it is 1 when x is greater than 0. It is 0 when x is equal to 0. And it is minus 1 when x is less than 0. As you can see, the left-hand limit of the signum function as x tends to 0 is minus 1. The right-hand limit as x tends to 0 plus is plus 1. And these two values are not the same. Correct. So we say limit does not exist. Limit of signum function as x tends to 0 does not exist. Okay. But what is the value of signum 0? That's 0. that exists. Is this fine? Is this clear? Yes, mod x by x can also be taken as an example, Kinshuk. Very good. Yeah. Are you getting my point? Any questions? Now, the third is what we want to discuss with you, that they may be equal also. Third case is where your limit of the function as x tends to a and the value of the function at a may be equal. Both may exist and both are equal. When will this happen? When will this happen? This occurs when your f of x is a continuous function at x equal to a. Okay. A simple example for the same. I'm sure I've given such examples before to you. Let's say x plus 1 as x tends to 1. Okay. This answer is 2. And even if you find out what is the value of this function, f of x defined by x plus 1 at x equal to 1, that will also be 2. So both these values are equal, and it is because such a function is a continuous function at 2. There is no problem. Okay, so x plus 1 graph is like this. So at x equal to 1, if you see the value of the limit and the value of the function, both will match with each other. Okay, so from these three cases, you realize that they are not the same things. F of x at x equal to a and limit of f of x as x tends to a, they are not the same things. I hope you can realize, when does the difference come in? The difference comes in when your function becomes undefined at that point, or there is a discontinuity occurring at that point. Is this fine? So please do not interchangeably use these two concepts. Fine. Now I'll give you some questions to begin with, because I want to test your basic understanding. Let's start with a very simple question. I have this question in front of me. Let me go to the next page. I hope you can all see the question. I'll just zoom in a bit. Yeah, there you go. Okay. For the function g whose graph is given, state the value of each quantity if it exists. State the value of each quantity if it exists. Okay. Now I would like you to answer the first part. What is g of t as x tends to 0 minus? Very good. Almost everybody is giving the right answer, minus 1. Good. Well done. Second one, what is the value of gt as x tends to 0 plus? Kinshuk, it's minus 2. Yes, excellent. Very good, guys. Third, what is the limit of g of t as x tends to 0? Very good. Non-existent. DNE. Very good. DNE. Absolutely. See, these are just the basic things. Let me tell you guys, JE will actually test you on these basic things. Don't expect very difficult questions to come in, but they will just try to attack, you know, your understanding through these simple problems. Okay. Limit of g of t as x tends to 2 minus. Very good. 2. Absolutely. If anybody feels that he is not agreeing with my answer, raise your hand, speak out, put your concern on the chat box. I'll answer your concern. Okay. G of t as x tends to 2 plus 0. Very good. Very good. G of t as x tends to 2. DNE. Very good. Very good. Next, seventh one. G of two. One, absolutely. As you can see, there's a dark dot over here. G of two is one. Very good. Eighth one. G of t as x tends to four. That is four. Yes. Because as you can see, slightly left to four, it is tending towards four. Slightly right to four, it is also tending towards four. So I think the first, the primary test that I wanted to give you, you have all cleared it. Very good. Your understanding about that is very good. So let's take another question. Okay. I hope you can all see the question. Yeah. For the function f whose graph is given, state the value of each quantity if it exists. Okay. What is the limit of f of x as x tends to 1? What is the limit of f of x as x tends to 1? Very good. Shraddha, why was the mistake for? As x tends to 1, see, left to limit, left to 1, you are near to 2. Right to 1, you are near to 3. The value doesn't match. So your left hand limit and right hand limit do not match. Your answer is D and E, doesn't exist. Got it? So those who are making a mistake, now it is clear why the mistake happened. Okay. Tell me the second one. Limit of f of x as x tends to 2. 3. Very good. Excellent. Third one. Limit of a function as x tends to 3. Anirudh, it's 3 only. See, what are you doing? The mistake that you're doing, you're looking at the value of the function at 3. Okay? Limit and the function value need not be the same. It is same when they're continuous. Here, obviously, there is a discontinuity at 3, right? There is a This type of discontinuity later on you will learn is called isolated point discontinuity. Okay. So left to 3, sorry for writing with white in white. Left to 3, the limit is 3. Right to 3 also the limit is 3. Are they equal? Yes. 3 will be the answer. Okay. Fourth one. Limit of f of x as x tends to 1.99. Fourth one, if possible, please put the question number. Limit of f of x as x tends to 1.99. The answer is 3 only. Okay, now see, 1.99, many people think it is a quantity which is very close to 2. No. 1.99 minus and 1.99 plus. It is different from saying 2 minus and 2 plus. Are you getting my point? So 1.99, let's say it is a point like this. Okay, you just have to see what is happening before 1.99 and after 1.99. In this example, before 1.99 and after 1.99, the values are both at 3. So limit here is 3. Are you getting my point? So don't treat 1.99 to be the same as a 2. Okay, there's a lot of difference. Next. What is the limit of the function as x tends to 3 minus? 3 minus, just before 3. That is also 3. So I think all these values are going to be 3. Okay. So this part is clear. No mistake in this. Very good. Now, let us talk about what are the methods that we'll be following? What are the methods that we'll follow to evaluate the limit of a function as x tends to a? Okay, I'll switch off my camera for some timing because I feel there is a small lag when I'm writing it. Just give me a second if it works. Yeah. Now, when you're evaluating the limit of a function as x tends to a, the approach that we take depends upon what kind of function are we dealing with? Okay. So normally we deal with two types of functions. So this function f of x can be of two types. One which is continuous at x equal to a. One which is continuous at x equal to a. For such cases, you don't have to worry, because the limit of this function as x tends to a will just be equal to f of a. Okay, I think the third point that we had discussed today, it is in line with that. Okay, the problem arises when your function is discontinuous at x equal to a, or undefined at x equal to a. Okay. So when a function becomes discontinuous at x equal to a, or it becomes undefined at x equal to a, then we basically have to apply our methods that we are going to see in some time. Now under these two cases, we basically call the function as an indeterminate form. So when a function exhibits discontinuity at a, or it is undefined at a, then we say that these are the indeterminate cases. Okay, so what are the indeterminate cases or indeterminate forms? I'd explain this to you in the bridge course, so I'll be slightly faster here. So indeterminate forms are of seven types. Yes, Shraddha, that is one of the seven types. So there are seven indeterminate forms that arises because of your function exhibiting any of these two characteristics. So what is the first form, which is the 0 by 0 form? But remember not to read it as 0 by 0. You should actually read as tending to 0 by tending to 0. Normally in your books, the word tending to is missing. That doesn't mean you'll stop reading it as tending to 0 by tending to 0. Okay, so read this in your mind as tending to 0 form. Second indeterminate form that probably I will not be able to touch in today's class. I'll not be able to cover up this. I'll only be able to cover up few forms under 0 by 0 is infinity by infinity form. Okay. Third one is infinity minus infinity form. Fourth one is tending to 0. Okay, I'll write it as 0 into infinity, but read it as 0 into infinity, but read it as to be read as tending to 0 into infinity form. Okay, this is how it is read. Okay, fifth is 1 to the power infinity form. Now again, it is not exactly 1 to the power infinity, because exactly 1 to the power infinity would be 1. It is actually tending to 1. Please read this as tending to 1 to the power of infinity. Okay, this is actually how it is read. Next is tending to 0 to the power tending to 0. So please read this as tending to 0 to the power tending to 0. Exactly 0 to the power 0 is also undefined in maths. Okay. And the last form is infinity to the power tending to 0. Read as infinity to the power tending to 0. Okay. So as you can see, this chapter is not small. What primarily you would have covered in school is just the 0 by 0 form. And of course, only NCERT level or school level stuff. 0 by 0 itself is a very lengthy concept under limits. Okay. Then comes infinity by infinity, infinity minus infinity, tending to zero into infinity, tending to one to the power infinity, then tending to zero to the power tending to zero, infinity to the power infinity. So seven indeterminate forms. It actually takes me around three classes to finish it. But I would try to do, you know, cover up as much as I can. Okay. So before we start with zero by zero form, I would like you all to understand algebra of limits. Have you all copied this down? Any question here, anybody? This is just a quick recap of whatever we had done in the bridge course. Now we'll talk about algebra of limits. Algebra of limits. Algebra of limits are the rules under which limits work. Okay. So of course, when you learn certain operations, there is a rule that governs those operations. Right. So if they're all happening together, what rules you basically apply? So let's say you know how to add, you know how to subtract, you know how to multiply, you know how to divide. But when all of them come together, what is the rule that basically governs the operation? That is what we are going to talk about under algebra of limits. So the first thing that I'm going to talk about is limit of the sum of two functions, f and g. Okay. Or difference of two functions is given by limit of f of x plus or minus, depending upon the case, limit of g of x as x tends to a. Okay. Now here I would like you to spend some time, because this rules looks to be very simple. Okay. But I have seen in JEE some very tricky questions have been formed on this rule, or some very tricky questions can be formed on this rule. So please note the following things very, very carefully. Or let me ask this like a question to you. Okay. Question is, think very carefully. Okay. Let me write points to be noted, or points to be kept under consideration. The first thing that I would like to ask you is, let us say, if limit of sum or difference, or whatever is the case, let's say I take the sum first, difference is also the same thing. If this limit exists, think carefully and answer, okay? Think carefully and answer. Does it mean both the limits f and g have to exist? Or my question can be seen in this way. If this limit exists, can it happen that the limit of f of x as x tends to a does not exist? And limit of x tends to a g of x also doesn't exist. Can it happen in this way? Some of you are saying no, some of you are saying yes. First of all, I would like to hear from the students who are saying yes, can you give me an example where the limit of the function f as x tends to a doesn't exist? Limit of g of x as x tends to a also doesn't exist. But the moment you add the two function f and g, its limit starts to exist as x tends to a. Okay, Aryan is saying yes, it can happen. Akshat is also saying yes, it can happen. Shraddha is saying yes, no, both. Shraddha, you will get run out. Yes, no, both calls are different, dangerous. Not sure. Okay, you change. Your final answer is no, Shraddha, right? Okay. So now, please let me tell you that there can be a case where both the limits doesn't exist, But when you add the two functions, the limit starts existing. A classic example, and how could you miss this example, is when you have your f of x as gif and your g of x is fractional part. How could you miss this example? This is such a classic example for the same. If somebody asks you, what is the limit of gif as x tends to 1? What will you say? What will you say? Doesn't exist, correct? GIF you have all seen. GIF graph you have all seen. It's like a step, correct? No. So at 1, left hand limit is 0, right hand limit is 1. So limit doesn't exist. Kinshuk, how is it 0? So this doesn't exist, right? Fractional part, even fractional part diagram, if you see, it is like this. Correct? This is the graph of fractional part of x. So left hand limit of fractional part as x tends to 1 is 1. Right hand limit of fractional part as x tends to 1 is 0. So left hand limit, right hand limit are different for fractional part. So even this doesn't exist. Even this doesn't exist. Okay. But the moment you add it, f of x plus g of x will become x, correct, and your limit of x as x tends to 1, that is existing, and that is 1. Okay, so a question may come in any competitive exam saying that f and g are such functions whose sum limit exists. So what can you comment on the following options, or which of the following options do you think can be true? So you may find such an option as one of your correct options. Okay. Can it happen? This is your situation number A. Situation number B is, can it happen that one of the limits doesn't exist? Let's say this does not exist and this exists. Can it happen that one of the limits f or g, whatever, okay, let me write or vice versa, or otherwise also, or vice versa also you can write. Can it happen that one of them exists, other doesn't, and your sum of the limit of f and g, or you can say sum of f and g limit as x tends to a exists. Can this happen? Okay, Prakul gives his answer. Very good. If yes, I would like to hear from you a case where one of the limit doesn't exist, other exists, and when you add the two functions, then the limit also exists. Can it happen like that? Okay, Kinshuk is saying yes. So he is the first person so far to say yes. So Kinshuk, can you give me an example for the same? I'm sure you would have come with an example. That's why you are saying like this. X plus 1 plus 1 by x minus 1. Okay, so let me write it. This is your which function? Okay, so there are two functions. X plus 1, I think this is what you are calling as f of x, correct? Correct. And g of x is what you are calling as 1 by x minus 1. Okay, and you're talking about x tending to 1. Okay, very good. So limit of x tending to 1 of f of x is 2, that is existing, very good. And limit of g of x as x tends to 1 does not exist. Okay, now what happens when you add them? What does it become? It becomes x plus 1 plus 1 by x minus 1, which is x square minus 1 plus 1 by x minus 1. This becomes x square by x minus 1. Do you think the limit of this as x tends to 1 exists? No, kinship. Correct. So your example doesn't work here. And in reality, you cannot find such examples because it cannot happen like this. Right? So the conclusion here is, so I'm erasing a kinship example. The conclusion here is, if your limit of f of x plus g of x exists, then it can never happen that limit of one of the function f or g, whichever you want, exists and the other one doesn't. Okay, so this case is not possible. Okay, so if you see an option like this, so they'll say, okay, limit of f of x plus g of x as x tends to a exists, then which of the following are possible? And you find the option where they say f is limit of f of x doesn't exist, limit of g of x exists. Or if you see an option like limit of f of x exists, limit of g of x doesn't exist, please do not mark that option. Okay, please do not mark that option. So it is not possible for this to happen. Okay, so remember, for your limit of f of x plus g of x to exist, either both the limits must exist, which is an obvious case. That is why I did not write it. So I can, let me write it in the C case. So either your both the limits exist, okay? Or in certain cases, if they both don't exist, then there may be a possibility that the limit will exist. Now don't get me wrong over here. I'm not saying that if both of them do not exist, this limit have to exist. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that if this limit f of x plus g of x as x tends to a exists, they can exist even when both of them are non-existent. So there can be cases like this when both of them are non-existent and this limit is existent. Are you getting my point? So don't get me wrong here, thinking that, oh, sir is trying to say that both must definitely not exist or both will definitely exist for me to have this limit existent. No. If this is true, the C condition, then this is always true. Okay. But even if both are non-existent, there may be a case, mark the word maybe, where f of x plus g of x limit as x tends to a exists. Okay, is this clear? Now, second important point to be noted, which I had discussed with you in the bridge course. If you have infinitely many terms added and all of them are tending to zero, then this funda will not work. If you have infinitely many terms, okay, the example which I cited in the bridge course, I still remember that example. I'll take that example. Let's say I want to evaluate the limit of 1 by n or 1 by n square, 2 by n square, 3 by n square, all the way till, let's say, n by n square, n tending to infinity. Okay. Now, one student who thinks or who doesn't know the caveat over here, what he will do is, okay, I'll evaluate the limit of each one of them separately. So he'll evaluate limit of 1 by n square. He will evaluate limit of 2 by n square. And he'll continue doing till he goes to limit of n by n square, n tending to infinity. And what he'll see, oh, n is a very large number. 1 by n has n square will be 0. This will also be 0. Okay, this will also be 0. So dot, 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 all of them will be 0. And he will write his answer as 0. And his marks will also be 0. Why his marks will be 0? What went wrong in this approach? What went wrong in this approach? No, it's not minus one, Prakul. The answer is actually half. Okay. Yes, absolutely, Gayatri. This is not a term which is, see, if there are finitely many terms like this, let's say 100, 200, 5,000, 1 lakh, 1 million, but they're finite, then still you can think of writing zero. No problem with that. But are the terms limited here? No, they are infinitely many terms. And each one of these terms are tending to zero. These terms are all tending to zero, my dear students. These are all tending to zero. So actually you have, I think I need to switch off my camera for some time. Yeah. So here you have infinitely many terms which are tending to zero. So it becomes actually tending to zero into infinity form. Right? The answer for this is anything. It could be anything. It depends upon how small is your zero and how big is your infinity. It's an indeterminate form. We cannot write this as zero into something. Right? Okay. So what is the right way to solve this? This is a wrong way to solve this. The right way to solve it is if you know your sum of 1 to n terms, you use that sum. Okay, I hope you all know your AP formula from your class 10. Okay, so this becomes n into n plus 1 by 2n square. Cancel off this n. Divide by this n which is in the denominator, both the numerator terms. So it becomes n by n plus 1 by n. N by n is 1 and 1 by n is 0. So your answer will become half. Your answer will become half. Okay. So this is the right way to deal with this problem. This is the right way to deal with this problem. Okay. Good. Next, we'll talk about rule number two. If you have product of two functions, f and g, okay, then you can evaluate this limit by using the formula or using the limits of each one of these functions separately and multiplying the result. Okay, now this is subject to the fact that it should not lead to any kind of indeterminacy. Okay. Oh, sure, Prakul. Prakul wants me to revisit the previous slide. Just give me a second, Prakul. System is not very fast today. Yes, anything that you would like me to answer here, or it is just that you want to copy something? Done, Prakul? Oh, thank you. Thank you. Yeah. Now, here also, some potential questions can be framed. So let me ask you, important point to be noted. If your limit of product of two functions f and g as x tends to a, x tends to a exists. Okay. Then let me give you some options. Then choose the correct option. Then choose the correct options. Correct options. Option A, limit of f of x as x tends to a now may not exist and limit of g of x as x tends to a also may not exist. Okay. Option B. Limit of extending to a f of x may not exist. And limit of g of x as x tends to a must exist or may exist. Option C, limit of f of x exists and limit of g of x as x tends to a may not exist. And option D, both of them must exist. Which of them could be your right options or option? Think carefully and then answer. Okay, so if B is correct, C will be correct. That everybody can make out from common sense, right? B and C will come together. So either both are rejected or both are accepted. And then A and D, you have to make a call. Yeah. Think, guys. I want you to think. Some of you are answering without thinking. It's a very simple, property that you may have read it 100 times while reading through the theory of your NCRT, but you may not have ever analyzed it. This is what JEE wants you to do. They want you to analyze. Okay, Dev, very good. So Dev, Madhumati, Shraddha, Stuti, Prakul, Gayatri, Kinshuk. I got answers from you people. What about others? I want everybody to participate. Okay, Ritu, very good. Rohan. Okay. One more minute I'll give you. Please think. If you want to correct your answer, do so. And then in 1 minute's time, we'll discuss it. We'll discuss kinship. We'll take examples also. Okay, now the verdict is all of the options can be correct. Surprised, right? Some of you are surprised. Correct? So all the options may be correct. So you may have the product of two functions limit existing even when both of them do not exist. Or even if one of them doesn't exist, another exists. And of course, when both exist, it has to be. So D is pakka correct. I don't see a reason to explain D. But I'll explain A, B, and C with some example. A, I can say, let's say, I have a function like this. Example for A. Let me write it like this. Example for A. If you have a function like this, which is defined as 2 when x is, let's say, greater than equal to 0 and minus 1 when let's say x is less than 0. Definitely, what is the limit of this function as x tends to 0? Or you can say 1 only, no need to write a minus 1 and 1. Okay. If I ask you what is the limit of this function as x tends to 0, what will you say? You will say, sir, it doesn't exist. Correct. Because left hand limit is 1 and right hand limit is 2. Correct. Yes or no? What is the limit of this function as x tends to 0. You say, sir, left hand limit for g as x tends to 0 is 2, and right hand limit of g of x as x tends to 0 is 1. So in this case also, the limit of g of x as x tends to 0 does not exist. Correct? All agree that both the limits do not exist. But see, when you multiply it, when you multiply these two functions, remember only those parts which are under the same domain will be multiplied. So greater than or equal to 0 part will be multiplied together, less than 0 part will be multiplied together. So it will be 2 when x is greater than or equal to 0, and again a 2 when x is less than 0. And in this case, you would realize that the limit of the product as x tends to 0 very much exists, and that is equal to 2. Okay. So remember, when both of them do not exist, just like our previous case, then the limit of the product may exist. May exist. Right? I'm not saying when every time both of them will be non-existent, their product will exist. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that even if the limit of both the functions individually do not exist, limit of the product may exist. May is the word here. Okay. So please do not mark this option as incorrect, because it may be existing, it may not be. Okay. For B, yes, Prakul has given a very good example for B. For B, you can take an example of 1 by x and sin x. Okay, that's a very good example, Prakul. So example for B, you can take your f of x to be sin x. Okay, we know that limit of sin x as x tends to 0 is 0. And you can take your g of x to be 1 by x. And we know that limit of 1 by x as x tends to 0 does not exist. Okay, but when it comes to their product, sin x by x limit as x tends to 0 becomes a 1. Okay, and you can swap their positions to justify C. So as I told you, if B is correct, C will also be correct. So C is also correct. And D, of course, when both of them are existent, the product limit will also exist for sure. Okay. Can it happen that both of them exist and the product limit doesn't exist? Can that happen? F of x limit exists, g of x limit exists, but their product limit doesn't exist. Can that happen in that way? It cannot happen. Okay. So these are the tricky questions that, you know, JE can frame and confuse you people. Okay. Let's move on to the property number 3. Okay. This is as good as limit of f of x as x tends to a divided by limit of g of x as x tends to a. Now again, let me tell you, it should not be that your denominator limit is becoming 0. It should not be that this should be becoming 0. Okay. If it is becoming 0, then your numerator limit should also be becoming 0. Then only this problem can be further solved. Of course, but not by this law, by some other law. Are you getting my point? But if your numerator limit is giving you some non-zero value and your denominator is giving you 0, then this case is a case of limit does not exist. Are you getting my point? For you to evaluate limit, it should be one of the 7 indeterminate forms. Now, which of the 7 indeterminate forms has a 0 in the denominator? Only one, 0 by 0 form, right? So if your numerator is non-zero and denominator is becoming 0, then your limit cannot be evaluated. You cannot find out the limits for such case. You can say limit does not exist. But if you feel that you have a function f by g whose limit exists, then you must have limit of your numerator function also tending to 0 as x tends to 0 if your denominator limit is becoming 0. It cannot happen that top is non-zero and bottom is zero. Both of them zero, then there is a scope of it getting solved. But don't think like that, it will definitely get solved. There is a scope of getting solved. Right? So we can save such a case. But if numerator is a non-zero quantity, let's say 5, denominator is becoming zero, then that case cannot be no solved. Are you getting my point? Okay. Next is, if you have any function multiplied with a constant, then constant is just multiplied to the limit result of the function. Okay, so you can always bring out the constant out of the picture. Next, if you have a limit of a function which is modded, then it is mod of the limit of the function as x tends to a. Okay. Please keep noting down these properties. They will be very helpful when you are solving a complicated question. So if you have limit of f of x raised to the power g of x, this is as good as limit of f of x as x tends to a raised to the power limit of g of x as x tends to a. Now this is subject to the fact that this should not be a 0 by 0 form. Sorry, this should not be tending to 0 to the power tending to 0 form. Okay. And this should not be tending to 1. In fact, you can't evaluate the limit of g in that case. So it should not be tending to 0 to the power tending to 0 form. If it is the case like this, then such a limit can be evaluated by further use of some other method, but not by this simple rule. Okay. Yeah, so tending to zero is another indeterminate form. It may give you different answers. We'll see that when we are doing this form, Prakul. I think check your list of indeterminate forms. This might be the 6th one or the 7th one. Okay, we'll talk about it, how to solve these kind of forms. 0 to the power 0 is not to be considered as 1. Many people think, sir, anything to the power 0 is 1, right? No. 0 to the power 0 is exactly 0 to the power exactly 0 is not defined in maths. Are you getting my point? Tending to 0 to power tending to 0 can be found out. Now people ask me, sir, won't it be 0 always? No. See, this 0 is to be read as something, or you can say a 1, let's say 1 divided by a very large quantity, infinite quantity. Okay. And this is to be read as a very small quantity, right? If you're finding infinite-th root of a small quantity, that can become a finite answer. Are you getting my point? If you're finding infinite-th root of a small quantity, it can become a finite answer. Are you getting my point? Okay. We'll come to it. The 7th one is the property which is meant for composite function. Yes, Kinshuk, that is correct. That is correct. That is something which I'll talk about in your tending to infinity kind of a limit. Okay. So if you want to find out what is the limit of f of x to which g of x is fed as an input, this is to be read as f of g of x. What will you read it as? F of g of x. Many books will write it as fog. Okay. So if you are evaluating the limit of fog as x tends to a, okay, this is given by limit of f of limit of g of x as x tends to a, provided Let's say I call this number as L, provided f of L exists. Okay. So, I mean, I can just give a dummy example here. Let's say your f was tan and your limit of g of x as x tends to, let's say something, gave you pi by 2. Then tan pi by 2 is undefined. So, in that case, we will not be able to find the limit by use of this simple law or by the use of this simple algebra. Then we have to apply, you know, other complicated funda, which we'll learn later on. Is this fine? Few special examples under this I can give you is the ones which are regularly seen. If you want to evaluate some examples, I can give you. If you want to evaluate log of a function or ln of a function, whatever, then it is log of the limit of the function. Now again, let me tell you, this answer should not be a negative value, else log will not work. Log works only for positive arguments. So it should not happen that you evaluated the limit of f and it came out to be negative 5. Then this limit does not exist. Okay. Another example would be exponential kind of functions. So if you have e to the power f of x or a to the power f of x, then you can evaluate the limit by raising f of x limit to the power of a. Okay. So these are some examples that you normally come across when you are dealing with questions. Is this fine? Is this fine? Okay. Eighth one. Have you all copied this? Can I move on to the right side of the board if you have copied it? Done? Okay. Eighth one. It's a simple property. It says that if a function f is less than equal to g in the neighborhood of x equal to a, Now people ask me, sir, what do you mean by neighborhood of x equal to a? Neighborhood of x equal to a means a minus delta, a plus delta close interval, okay, where delta is an infinitesimally small quantity. Okay, then even your limit of f of x as x tends to a will be less than or equal to limit of g of x as x tends to a. Okay. So it just says that if your value, if the function f is always below g of x in the neighborhood of a, then even the limit value of f of x will be lesser than limit of g of x value as x tends to. Okay. Simple. This is basically, you can say, half of your sandwich theorem. I'll talk about sandwich theorem a little later on when I'm deriving your trigonometric limits. So please copy this. And we'll take some questions, based on this. Yes, your inequality will depend on the given functions. Absolutely. Yeah, Dev has a question. Yes, everything Kinshuk, don't worry. A to Z, I'll cover this topic. Okay. Yeah, Kinshuk, Dev has a question. If limit of f of x is not defined or doesn't exist, then? Oh, you're talking about this question, Dev. This is subject to the fact that they exist. Okay, chalo, I'll add this point if they exist. Happy now? Good point, actually. I should have written it. Very good point. Let's take questions. Again, this is just testing your basics. I've not yet started talking about methods to evaluate limits. I'm just testing your basics. Okay, now here, all the brackets that you see are greatest integer function brackets. Okay. So I'll put the poll on. Once solved, please press on the poll button. Very good. Two of you have responded so far. Options are given, no, Kinshuk? 0, 1, minus 1 does not exist. Okay, Aryan, fine. Noted down your answer. No. I'm getting different answers. Some of them have given A, some of them B, then some of them C, and some of them D. Okay, we'll stop this poll in another 30 seconds. 11 of you haven't voted yet. Last 15 seconds. Five. 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. Now, end of poll. Let me share the result with you. Most of you have gone with option number A. Okay. That is 0. Let's check. So, in this case, let us evaluate the left-hand limit first. The limit of this function as x tends to pi by 2 minus. Okay. Now, sine of x, when you are slightly less than pi by 2, can I say you are slightly less than 1? Correct. Sine x, when you are slightly less than pi by 2, let's say your angle is 89.999999 degree. Sine of that will be slightly less than 1. Even if it is 0.999, what will GIF do to it? It will make it fall to 0. Correct. What about cos? Slightly less than 90 degree, it is a positive small quantity. Correct. I hope you can relate it to the graph of cos x. This is pi by 2. Slightly left to pi by 2, let's say pi by 2 minus, cos will be a very small positive value. Correct? GIF of that will also become a 0. Right? So this will also become a 0. So you will end up getting GIF of 1 by 3, that is anyways a 0. So left hand limit is 0 for sure. What about right hand limit? So limit x tending to pi by 2 plus. Okay. Now when you're slightly more than pi by 2, sine is slightly lesser than 1 again because it achieves its maximum value of 1 at pi by 2. So here and there, about 90 degree, left or right of 90 degree, its value is going to become solpa less than 1. So its GIF will become 0 again. But what about GIF of cos x? Now the moment you cross pi by 2, let's say pi by 2 plus, cos is going to become a very small negative number, but GIF of that small negative number will become a minus 1. Okay, so it will become this by 3. Anyways, this is GIF of 2 by 3. That's again 0. So left hand, right hand limit, both are equal and both are 0. So undoubtedly your answer is option number A. Okay. Now, a serious JEE aspirant will ask this question. What if your GIF bracket was outside? For example, let's say I change the same question. I would like you to tell me the answer for the same. If I had asked you, what is GIF of limit extending to pi by 2 of GIF of sin x minus GIF of cos x plus 1 whole divided by 3? What will your answer be in this case? Sin pi by 2 plus Kirtana, see, this is a graph of sine pi by sine graph, right? So this is your pi by 2. So this value is 1. Slightly more than pi by 2, you'll be at, let's say, 0.9999999, whatever. The moment you take GIF of it, won't it drop to 0? Yes. So what is the answer for this? So Shambho says, okay. Rohan, okay. Kinshuk, okay. Very good. The answer here is it will not exist, because the inside limit itself doesn't exist. So why should we talk about the, see, for any function which is a composition of function to exist, you will learn this later on in 12th. Let's say I talk about f of g to exist. First of all, g must exist. Okay. If inside most function itself is not existing, then we don't care about what is happening to the overall function. Correct. So I'm talking about a GIF case over here, where I have two functions. One is the GIF, other is the inside limit. Okay. If the inside answer itself is not, you know, existing, then we don't care about the overall. We say it will not exist. So answer is it doesn't exist. Okay. Now people would say zero for this also, and they would get it wrong. This is where JEE will trick you. This is where JEE will trick you. Shraddha, just now we saw, no? If you just ignore the outside GIF, it will become 1 by 3 here and it will become 2 by 3. 1 by 3, 2 by 3 are different, no? I changed the question. I have brought the outermost GIF outside the limit. Okay. So for this part, which I am showing with curly brackets, your left hand limit was 1 by 3, right hand limit was 2 by 3. So limit itself doesn't exist, right? So, okay. So please be careful of these small tweaking in the questions. It has tricked a lot of people. Okay, let's take this question. Hey, where is that question gone? Okay, I'll write down the question for you. Sorry. Limit of x tending to minus 7. GIF square, GIF x square, plus 15 GIF of x, plus 56. Whole divided by sine of x plus 7 into sine of x plus 8. I will not give you any options. I would like you to give me the answer for this question. This bracket signifies GIF. So the square bracket that you can see is GIF. So again, I'll repeat the question. Limit of x tending to minus 7, limit x tending to minus 7 of GIF x whole square plus 15 GIF x plus 56 upon sine x plus 7 into sine x plus 8. Okay, Akshat, very good. Yeah, Dev, hence the question actually. The question is primarily because it is a 0 by 0 form. Yeah, so limit exists. What is the answer? No, I don't know. I have not seen the module that carefully. It may be there. Okay, Ruchita, very good. What is that kinshuk? I didn't get you. 0 by 0 and 0 by 0. Are, 0 by 0 is not an answer. 0 by 0 is just the form. You can't write an answer of a limit as a 0 by 0. It just tells you the form. What is the answer for that 0 by 0 is what limit helps you to find out. Limit is a tool which helps you to get answers to 0 by 0 form. Okay, so three of you have responded so far. One is Ruchita, other is Akshat, and other is Prakul. Okay, Gayatri, Dev, very good. Okay, Kinshuk. Okay, let's discuss this in the interest of time. We can all see that your numerator is factorizable. Isn't it? Correct me if I'm wrong. Your numerator is factorizable. Denominator, let it be as it is. Okay. Now, let us evaluate what is the limit of this function as x tends to minus 7 minus. Minus 7 minus means you are slightly less than minus 7. Probably minus 7.000001. You are slightly less than minus 7. Less than minus 7. Okay, slightly less than minus 7. Now, if you are slightly less than minus 7, what will be the value of GIF of x? You say, sir, simple, it will be minus 8. Okay. What will be the value here? That will be minus 8 plus 0. Correct. What will happen to the denominator? Denominator, this term would be tending to zero term. I'll just write it like this. I hope you can understand what I'm trying to write. And this will be tending to sine 1. Correct. Now here, the answer is actually 0. It is not a 0 by 0. It is not a tending to 0 by tending to 0 form. Guys and girls, please pay attention. This is actually exactly 0 by tending to 0. Okay. And this is not an indeterminate form. Its answer is plain and simple, 0 and nothing else. Because your numerator is exactly 0. So it doesn't matter whether your denominator is a small positive number, a small negative number, or a number tending to 0. The whole answer is exactly 0. It is not an indeterminate form. Please do not get this. Please do not confuse this with a tending to 0 by tending to 0 form. Your numerator is not tending to 0, my dear. It is exactly 0. Getting my point? If it is exactly 0, then don't try to apply anything, any formula and all. Plain, simple, 0. That's the end of the game. Right? So I wanted to see whether that concept of tending to 0 by tending to 0, are you able to distinguish it from exactly 0 by tending to 0? Of course, exactly 0 by exactly 0 cannot be evaluated. Correct. So tending to 0 by tending to 0 is an indeterminate form which can be evaluated. Exactly 0 by tending to 0 is pakka 0. Force. No second thought about it. Okay. So left hand limit is 0. What about right hand limit? Right hand limit, if you see, as x tends to minus 7 plus. Minus 7 plus doesn't mean plus minus 7. Okay. Minus 7 plus means you are slightly higher than minus 7. Probably minus 6.9999 kind of a thing. Right. So if you take a GIF, now come back to this step. If you take the GIF of minus 6.99, it'll give you a minus 7. So it becomes minus 7 plus 7 by minus 7 plus 8 by a quantity again tending to 0. By quantity again tending to 1, I believe, sine 1, I believe. But it is a case where your numerator is exactly 0. Denominator may be tending to 0. So this is a case of, this is not a case of indeterminate form. This is a case of just writing 0 as the output. Are you getting my point? So is the left hand limit, right hand limit the same? You'll say, yes, sir, very much. They are the same. So your answer for this question is 0. Any questions here, anybody? Okay, so now you would be realizing that there is a lot of fine tuning happening with your understanding. Yes, yes. Meghna, you need not factorize it. I factorize it just to make it very clear, evident. But without factorizing also, if you do, you'll end up getting 0 on the numerator anyhow. Whether you are going to minus infinity, minus 7 minus or minus 7 plus. Yes, of course, Prakul, but provided your limit of the function should not be tending to 0. Okay. Now we'll be talking about methods to evaluate limits. Methods to evaluate limit of a function. So if you realize your function is a continuous function at x tending to a or x equal to a, my bad. If you realize your function f of x is continuous at x equal to a. Continuous at x equal to a means no breakage, no hole at x equal to a. Then you can evaluate your limit by just using the formula f of a. Okay. Now, how would you come to know a function is not continuous or a function is continuous at x equal to a? Of course, one is by making the graph, but that is not an easier route. You say, sir, difficult functions will come. How do you expect us to make graph and all for that? Okay, I understand. But at least you can try to put the value of a into the function and see if it is giving you a, you know, 0 by 0 or infinity by infinity. If all those indeterminate forms do not come up, that means it's a case where your function was continuous at x equal to a. Correct? For example, let's say if I give you this limit to evaluate, x square plus 2x plus 3, and I say evaluate the limit of this as x tends to 1. The moment you put 1 in the place of x, you realize that you end up getting a 6. 6 is a, you know, finite quantity. So this answer will also become the limit of the function. Okay. So if you end up getting something which is, you know, weird, like 0 by 0 or infinity by infinity, or, you know, even tending to 1 to the power infinity, or any of the 7 indeterminate forms, there you should realize that this is not a case where the function is continuous at x equal to a. So I cannot evaluate it by substitution. Okay. So as I already told you in the bridge course, substitution may not be the first step of any problem, but it definitely is the last step of every problem. Okay. So your teacher might not give you any question where you have to apply substitution from the word go. Right. It is like, you know, giving freebies to you. So they'll not give you marks like that. But yes, having said that, the last step of every problem solving requires substitution. What is the exact purpose of limit? That is a very good question. Exact purpose of limit is when you are evaluating dy by dx. That's the derivative. Dy by dx is what? Dy is a quantity which is tending to 0. Dx is also a quantity which is tending to 0. So when you are evaluating dy by dx, means your entire derivative is actually limits. Nothing else. Getting the point? So limit is to see how is your numerator changing with respect to the denominator when these changes may be either very large or very small. That is the purpose of limits. Very good question, Kinshuk. Okay. I think you were not there in the bridge course when I talked about it. Are you there? Or you were not there? Okay. Okay. Next is your method of factorization. This is called method of substitution. Let me write it. This is called method of substitution. Method of substitution. Next is your method of factorization. Method of factorization. Method of factorization is mostly used when you have two functions, f and g, where you realize that when you put a into f, you get 0. And you put a into g also, you get 0. Implying that x minus a is a factor of f of x and g of x. Acha, one more thing I would like to highlight over here. Even though I'm using the word factor, it is not necessary that when you put a in f and you get 0 and you put g in a and you get a 0, that means x minus 1 has to come out as a factor. No, I don't mean to say that. For example, let's say your f of x was e to the power x minus 1, correct? And your denominator was, let's say, tan x, and a was 0. So putting 0 in place of x will give you a 0. Putting 0 in place of x in this one will also give you 0. That doesn't mean x is a factor of e to the power x minus 1 or x is a factor of tan x. I don't mean to say that. If at all you can take out a factor of x minus a from f and g function. Okay. In other words, so people say, sir, why don't you say f and g are polynomials? Then it will make more sense. No, even for non-polynomials also, some factors can be pulled out. So I don't want to make both the statements. Are you getting my point? So I'm basically choosing my words very carefully. I don't want to call f and g polynomials because it is not limited to polynomials. x minus a could be pulled out as factors even when the expression is not a polynomial. For an irrational function, probably. Irrational functions are not polynomials. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is, if your f of a is 0 and g of a is 0 and x minus a can be pulled out as a factor from both f of x and g of x, then you can write this particular expression like this. Okay. That means x minus a could be taken out as a factor, leaving behind capital F of x. You can call that as your quotient if you want to. And leaving g of x, capital G of x, as your quotient for the denominator term. And then you can cancel off these factors and then put your a in place of x over here and here. Provided you again do not end up in an indeterminate form. So this should be a finite answer. Okay. Are you getting my point? So if you get a 0 by 0 again, that means again there is a scope of x minus a to be pulled out as a factor, or probably you can have other ways implemented or applied to it to get the job done. Are you getting my point? Not a new thing for us. We have done few examples on this in our BITCH course also. So we'll take some questions directly on this. Okay, let's take this question. X tending to root 2, x to the power 4 minus 4 upon x square plus 3x root 2 minus 8. I'll put the poll on. Done. Let's finish this up in 1 minute. You all have done enough of factorization based questions with me in the BITCH course. Both are polynomials, thankfully. So method of factorization can really help us in this problem. One person has answered so far. Dear students, last 30 seconds for this. Please vote. Simple question to solve. Last 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. 16 of you haven't voted yet. Okay, anyways. Most of you have gone for C. Let us see whether C is the right option or not. Numerator is definitely factorizable with a factor of x minus root 2. So you can factorize this as x square plus 2 into x square minus 2. X square minus 2 can be further be factorized like this. So I'm not writing every step over here. Our denominator, if you see, this term can be split up as 4x root 2 minus x root 2 minus 8. So if you take an x common, it will be x plus 4 root 2. And if you take a minus root 2 common here, it will become x plus 4 root 2. So it will become x minus root 2 times x plus 4 root 2. X minus root 2, x minus root 2, that is the problem creating factor. I always call this as a problem creating factor because this is the one which is responsible for creating a zero on the numerator and a zero in the denominator. Okay, you can check it is actually a 0 by 0 form to begin with. Now, again, I'm writing 0 by 0, but how would I read it? Tending to 0 by tending to 0. It is not exactly 0 by exactly 0. Exactly 0 by exactly 0, nothing can be done about it. Exactly 0 by tending to 0, that is 0. No need to do any kind of a method for that. But this is tending to 0 by tending to 0. So there we need to apply our methodologies. So once you have got it, you can just go for the substitution. So when you substitute, you end up getting 2 plus 2. This will become root 2 plus root 2. And this will become root 2 plus 4 root 2, which clearly gives you 4 times 2 root 2 upon 5 root 2. So root 2 gone. Answer is 8 upon 5. Janta was correct.
Aap jeet gaye 1 crore rupaye.
Okay, next. Okay, try this one. Now, prima facie, it is actually infinity by infinity. Prima facie means from the first observation, it looks like infinity by infinity, yes. But let me tell you later on, you will realize that these indeterminate forms are interconvertible. Okay, so infinity minus infinity can be changed to 0 by 0 also. Okay, try this out. I'm going to wait for you to answer. Let me give you options. Let me give you the poll. No. Normal brackets. Kirtana, they are normal brackets. Unless until stated, don't treat square brackets to be GIF. It will be mentioned in the question that any square bracket is GIF, then only use it as GIF, else they are plain and simple normal brackets. Done. Only one person has answered so far. Okay, very good. Let's finish this up in another 30 seconds. 5 people have responded so far. Oh. Okay, last 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Go. Come on, guys. 17 of you haven't voted yet. Fast, 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 fast. Okay. Let's discuss it. By the way, most of you have gone for D, does not exist. Okay, let us check. So here, first of all, I'll take the LCM. By the way, even before doing that, I would like to factorize this. And this is factorizable as x minus 1, x minus 2. Okay. I would like to take the LCM here first. LCM would be x, x minus 1, x minus 2 square. Correct? Okay. So this will give me x minus 1 minus, this will give me x, x minus 1. Oh, sorry, x, x minus 2. My mistake. Okay. Let us see what does the numerator simplify to. So this will give you negative x square plus 2x plus x, which is 3x. And you'll have minus 1. Negative x square plus 2x, which is 3x, minus 1. Is this fine? Any questions in these steps so far? Anything that I have missed, please highlight. Good enough? No problem. Okay. Now, the numerator, if you see, as x tends to 2, is minus 4 plus 6 minus 1, which is not a zero term. And denominator is becoming 0. So you have a case where numerator is not 0 and denominator is 0. So it don't start applying your method of, you know, factorization on this. It's a case where limit does not exist, plain and simple. Right? So please unnecessarily do not apply limits to such cases which were not indeterminate forms at all. It was a case of limit doesn't exist. Simple as that. Okay. If your numerator was coming zero and denominator was coming zero, then there would have been some scope. Some scope would have been left. I'm not saying even then your limit must exist. No. But this is a case which is scopeless. Or hopeless. We cannot go any, you know, further from that, because numerator is a non-zero quantity, denominator is zero quantity, limit doesn't exist. Option number T is correct. Janta was correct. Next. I did this problem. Yeah, let's do this question. Limit of 4x cube minus x square plus 2x minus 5 upon x to the power 6 plus 5x cube minus 2x minus 4 extending to 1. I'll put the poll on. 3 minutes is what I'm going to give you for this.
Okay, one person has responded. Two people have responded. Very good. Nice, 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 nice. I don't know the answer, Aryan. Even I'm also solving along with you. We'll see. We'll see which option is correct. Okay, last 1 minute. Last 1 minute for this. See, first thing that you would all notice is that it's a 0 by 0 form, right? The moment you put x equal to 1, it cannot be solved by substitution. That's for sure. Everybody would have realized it. So when you put a 1, you get 4 minus 1 plus 2 minus 5 upon 1 plus 5 minus 2 minus 4. That's 6 minus 6, 0. Again, 6 minus 6, 0. It's a 0 by 0 form. Okay. Now, let me tell you, it is 0 by 0 exactly when you're putting x equal to 1. Right, so many people ask me, sir, you only told exactly 0 by exactly 0, we cannot do anything. Right, but x is not equal to 1, x is tending to 1. See here, x is tending to 1. So instead of being exactly 0 by exactly 0, it is actually tending to 0 by tending to 0. So we can do something about it actually. So definitely both are polynomials, and when you're putting 1 in both of them, you're getting 0, which means x minus 1 is a factor for both the polynomials. So what I'll do is I'll try to bring out the quotient. When you divide the numerator and denominator respectively by x minus 1. So many people would be doing this step. So you would divide your numerator by x minus 1. Okay. And you'll also be dividing your denominator by x minus 1. So you have to do this operation. Okay. And yes. Okay. By the way, I'll stop the poll here. Most of you have replied with option D. This is the reply of most of you. Okay. Let's see whether D is correct. And you'll also divide x to the power 6 plus 5x cube minus 2x minus 4 by x minus 1. Right. This is what you'll be doing. And most of you would be using long division method. While long division method is good for your school exams, but it is very time consuming when you are applying it in competitive exams. So for competitive exams, we normally mention a method which we call as the Horner's method, also called as the synthetic division method. So I told this method in the bridge course. Some of you still remember it. I can see that. So those who were not there in the bridge course, for them, it's a new thing. Probably you would have learned this in class 10th. Tushar sir would have definitely taught Horner's method. Okay. So in this method, what do? Is let's say I want to do this operation. Okay. So first of all, I will write down this polynomial from increasing to decreasing power without missing out any factor. Without missing out any power. So as you can see, there is no power being missed out. So I've written it like this. Okay. Then I will take its coefficient 4, minus 1, 2, minus 5. So all the coefficients I took down. Okay. Now, since you're dividing by x minus 1, write a 1 over here. Okay. So basically, I'm telling you a shortcut for long division. Okay, so Horner method or synthetic division is a shortcut by which you can divide any polynomial of any degree by a linear polynomial. Yes, this is a limitation actually. This method is not a complete replacement for long division. Long division method can be used even when you are dividing it by a quadratic or by a cubic or by a biquadratic. Okay. But Horner method is used only when you are dividing by a linear term like this. So that is the limitation of Horner's method. Okay. Now, how does it work? See the modus operandi for this. How does it work? First, you put a zero over here by default every time. Every time you put a zero below the very first coefficient that you have written. Okay. Add these two. What is 4 plus 0? 4. Multiply 4 with this number that is sitting over here. So multiply these two and write the result over here. So 1 into 4, 4. Write it over there. So whatever is the number there, let's say if you were dividing by x minus 2, then 2 would have come there. So 2 into 4, 8 would have come over here, right? Okay, so whatever is that number, multiply it with this sum and write over here. Then again add. Then again multiply. Then again add. Again multiply and then again add. That will give you a zero. Okay. This last number that you see is actually the remainder. We all know that x minus 1 is a factor of this 4x cubed minus x squared plus 2x. So remainder must come out to be 0. That's why 0 is coming out. And what about these numbers that you have written? 4, 3 and 5. Basically write them down in a reverse manner with increasing power of x starting from 0. Okay. That means this becomes your quotient. This is your quotient. Okay, see how less you have to write. Within two lines, your long division method is done. Correct. Let us apply, those who have not learned this method, let us apply it again on the second one, this one. Again, x to the power 6, 5. Now, remember, you have to write down all the terms without missing out even a single power of x. So, x to the power 6 is there, but x to the power 5 is not there. So, what will you do? You will write 0x to the power 5. Okay. Then you will write 0x to the power 4. Then you will write 5x cube. Then you will write 0x square because there is no x square term. Then you will write a minus 2x. Then you will write a minus 4. Okay. Now bring down these coefficients. So 1, 0, 0, 5, 0, minus 2, minus 4. Make this weird symbol over here. There's no meaning for this symbol. Many people say, why do you draw this symbol? You can draw any symbol you want. It is just to separate these terms from this number. That's it. By default, write a 0. 1 plus 0 is 1. 1 into 1 is 1. 0 plus 1 is 1. 1 into 1 is 1. 0 plus 1 is 1. 1 into 1 is 1. 5 plus 1 is 6. 1 into 6 is 6. 0 plus 6 is 6. This into this will be 6. Then this will be 4. Then this will be 4 and the last will be 0 pakka. If last one is not coming out to be 0, that means you have done some mistake. You have done some mistake. Okay. Now, start writing these numbers from the last one, which is the 4, starting from power x equal to 0. So, 4x to the power 0, 6x, 6x square, x cube, x4, x to the power 5. So, this will become your quotient. This will become your quotient. See how efficient it is. Okay. I didn't get, since the denominators are same for all the options, we need not factorize it, right? Oh yes, I think you figured out from the options that denominators are all 19, 19, 19. That's a very good move. You can save that. You can take that approach and save a lot of time. But right now my duty is to tell you the full procedure of solving the question. Okay. So this question as x tends to 1, you can write the numerator as x minus 1, 4x square plus 3x plus 5. Denominator as x minus 1, x to the power 5, x to the power 4, x to the power 3, 6x square, 6x plus 4. Now, this is a problem creating factor gone. Okay. So, numerator will give you 4 plus 3 plus 5, which is 12. Denominator will give you 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 6 plus 6 plus 4. Okay. That is 12 by 19 is your answer, which is given by option number D. So it's a good learning for people who were not there with us in the bridge course. This is how you can do quick division. Okay. Is this fine? Let's take up the next question. Evaluate this limit. Limit x tending to pi by 4, 1 minus cot cube x by 2 minus cot x minus cot cube x. Now, many of you would be thinking, ayo, sir has started trigonometric limits also here. Actually, no. Yeah, I'll not give out the options. You will have to type it out in the chat box. One minus cot cube divided by two minus cot x minus cot cube x tending to pi by 4. Extremely happy to see a nearly full turnout even on a test day. That's the spirit. Hats off to all of you. I understand UT days are very critical, but almost everybody is present for the class. That's a good sign. Done? Okay, Akshat. Good. Okay, last 30 seconds. Okay, Shambho, very good. Good, Rohan. Guys, let it be wrong. I don't care about right or wrong. I care about you giving me the answer. Oh, of course, don't write anything that you feel like. Giving me the answer is like synonymous with you making an attempt to solve it. That is more important to me. Okay, Stuti, Ruchita, very good. No solution. Is this an equation that you're trying to solve? That you're saying no solution? Doesn't exist, that is what you want to say? Okay. There is a solution. The limit does exist. Don't worry. Prakul also, limit exists. Okay. So let us solve this question. Let us solve this question. See, treat it as if you are dealing with cortex replaced with some variable t. This is called intermediate substitution. So you are making an intermediate substitution in order to convert it to a form which is easy for you to work on. Correct. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to call my cot of x as a t. So as x tends to pi by 4, t will tend to 1. Correct. So this limit is as good as evaluating the limit of 1 minus t cube by 2 minus t cube, t tending to 1. Both will give me the same answer. Okay. Now this is much easier to deal with because I can easily see that it is factorizable. I'm sure we can factorize the numerator as 1 minus t, 1 plus t square. What about the denominator? Denominator, let us do one thing. Let us apply our Horner's method. Okay. You're dividing by t minus 1, right? You're dividing this by t minus 1. So Horner method, what do? We write 1. Okay. And we write the coefficients of these different powers of t. Minus 1, 0, minus 1, 2, 0. It's very fast actually. Minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 2, minus 2, 0. So that will give you t minus 1 minus t square minus t minus 2. Okay. So you can do one thing. You can cancel out this 1 minus t and this and take away the negative sign from here. Okay. Then put your t value as 1. It becomes 3 upon 4. So the answer is 3 by 4. I think only one person got, no, Vaibhav got it right. Vaibhav got it right, Rohan got it right, Akshat got it right. Very good, well done. Others made some sign mistakes. Okay. Next is method of rationalization.